do, do. Merry go, merry go, merry go round. Do, do, do. Me and you can go merry go round. It's very easy, just go up and down. Come on, come on, let's merry go, merry go.
If you know the Alcoholics' Psalm, the Lord is my shepherd, he maketh me lie down in strange postures. I was in a pub the other night and it was half price Malibu night. It's funny, isn't it, when drinks manufacturers want to sell us a drink, they give it a distant exotic place name like Malibu. Wonder if there's a load of people in Malibu drinking a drink called Barnsley.
These Alco Pops are really getting out of hand.
The lying bastards who make them say they're not encouraging kids to start drinking young. Then how do they explain this? Outrageous. It's one of the mysteries of retailing, I suppose. There's a lot of mysteries connected with retailing. Like, take these plastic trays that bread's delivered to shops in. Why do they always leave them lying about in the street? I mean, does your bread taste better if it's been in something that a dog's pissed on? You know, when you go to the bookies, right? In there, they have these tiny little pens, don't they? Tiny, nidgety, widgety, gidgety little biros in there. Tiny, nidgety, nudgety, podgety, fudgety, Dudley Moore, penis-sized little pens they've got in there. I mean, what's that all about, eh? They expect a load of jockeys to come in. Hello, hello, I'm down here. Hello, I want to place a bet. I'm a little jockey, I want to place a bet. Oh, I can't use this full-size pen. Oh, no, it's too big for me. Oh, no. I was in this posh restaurant in London the other night, the Savoy. It was quiz night. I do like eating out though, but there's a lot of stupid rules connected with eating out, isn't there? Like you should only ever drink white wine with fish. That's bloody stupid, isn't it? Have you ever tried getting pissed with a haddock? It'd be bloody useless in a fight. I'll take these two, you suck the other one.
Kinder say in their advertising that their chocolate egg satisfies kids in three ways. They get a chocolate, a toy, and a surprise. Well, they do get a chocolate, that's fair enough. They also get a toy. But the toy is meant to be the surprise. And how can it be a surprise? It says you're gonna get a toy on the egg. No, no, no. It'd be more of a surprise, right, if you opened up your egg and inside found a little note that said,
"There is no God."
Mummy, Mummy,
yes, there is no God.
My, that is a surprise.
Get real with the fever on the dance floor.
If you're wondering why I'm risking my life on these, it's because I've been told to appeal to young people, specifically the 18 to 35 group, because they're apparently the only people that manufacturers, advertisers and the BBC really cares about.
Well, as one of the managers of this old people's home, we felt we weren't maximising our basic resource, i.e. the house, by housing old people. So now we've decided to target the 18 to 35 age group.
Strongly contrasted groups. Sandy?
No.
Oh, bad luck.
While this may seem odd, in fact, it makes perfect sense. When you go into a home, all they do is pump you full of drugs and then make you watch TV all day in a big coat to keep you warm. Which is exactly what young people like doing.
It's that time again. Everybody ready?
And how are we today? There, that didn't hurt, did it? Let's try again. Better.
Feet off the furniture. Thank you. Oh, I think you'll live. Up we go. That's it.
I'm gonna set myself up as a DJ. I'm gonna DJ smells. I'm gonna mix the smells and it's gonna be mental.
Yes, yes, of course it is. You have to humour them.
I'm gonna open up a hairdressing salon. It's not gonna be boring though, it's gonna be cool. When you get your hair cut, you have to sit on a motorbike.
Oh, that sounds like fun. When are you going to do that?
I'll do it tomorrow. There's good telly on today. Yeah, do it tomorrow.
That's a good idea. You do it tomorrow. And they have more money to spend on sticky buns and Complan. And of course, once you get the young people inside, you've got them for life. An old person might only stay for, what, 10 years? An 18-year-old in a home will be paying his bills for the next 60 years at least. Kids.
So here we are in the heart of Soho, London's red light district. Though compared with the full-on pornography of a city like Amsterdam, it's more of a Tomy nightlight district. One of the bizarre hazards connected with walking along these streets is the danger of being knocked into the road by men emerging at high speed from sex shops.
You see, I have observed there are only two ways the punters leave mucky bookshops. The first way is to sidle out, but that leaves you exposed for far too long a time to be seen by the pretty girl from the office who you're going to invite out tomorrow. The other method is to get out of there as quickly as possible in order to avoid embarrassment. So what they do is they come hurtling out of there using a strange lolloping half walk, half run, and then have to make an abrupt 90 degree turn in order to rejoin the moving crowd on the pavement. If they're not careful, they can lose their footing and fall under the wheels of a speeding car. Another victim of safe sex.
I think that pornography degrades both men and women. But men consume it because they're unaware of what it is like to be perceived solely as a sex object. You see, if men knew what it was like to have breasts, it would give them a whole different perspective on things, especially when looking down at their shoes. But I think that what men have to do is imagine what it's like to have these things on your chest that other men would pay a fortune just to stroke and fondle and would risk even their marriages just to hold. But I never figured out how men could sample this experience until I read about a journalist in the 1970s in America, a white guy who wrote a load of articles about what it was like to be discriminated against by having his skin dyed black. Of course, I can't really think why they didn't get a black writer to write the articles, but then that's journalism for you. I realised that I could replicate what it is like to have breasts by strapping to my chest something that men would like to look at, stroke and fondle. I finally decided on a rather nice pair of porcelain figurines by the great 18th century artist John Flaxman.
Now I was ready to experience what it was like to be a woman.
Well, I have to tell you, it's even more disturbing than I thought it would be, having a couple of pottery shepherdesses stuck to the front of your jumper. To be talking to a man at a party and to have his eyes constantly wandering away from your face down to your chest is probably an experience familiar to most women, but one which I found deeply shocking. And I have to say, people treated me completely differently when I was wearing my breast substitute and when I wasn't. In a matter of hours, I was reduced to shouting back at catcalling building workers. What? Ain't you seen a pair of these before? Is there a message here for society? I think there isn't.
They're making music to watch girls buy.
Sir? You, sir? Anything for you, sir? Sir?
I actually spend a lot of time in porn cinemas, and if you think it's because I'm a sad pervert, you'd be semi-wrong.
You see, porn films, apart from featuring round-the-clock shagging, also tackle important social issues. For example, there's the sexy history of the American Civil Rights Movement, Malcolm Triple X. There's the saucy story of the suffragettes, Sexy Vixens Do It Horsey Style. And who can forget this classic?
Sin.
Support is very strong in South Armagh.
Yes, so it is. God, it's hot in here.
Aye.
I'm from the RUC, and this is a riot.
I've got one thing to say to you. You've got one hell of a cute ass.
Hey, why don't I get any action around here?
I'm from the UBF, and hey, I'll come to the table for you out.
Go on.
Go on.
You can march through my area.
Well, it would definitely be a surprise if you opened up your egg and then...
Wow! Mummy, Mummy!
Yes?
Look, Mummy. Documentary proof that Malcolm X was shot by the FBI.
Ooh, so it is. What a treat for you.
When you're a top-notch comedian, it's important that you stay well informed. What I like to do is I like to get my news via CFAX. Unfortunately, though, I'm out a lot. So what I do is I videotape CFAX and then watch it later. Of course, I never do. So now I've got stacks and stacks of videotapes of out-of-date weather forecasts, traffic reports, and news flashes. That's why I've only just learned the Prince's shop in Camden Town has closed down. Yeah, Prince, the pop star's shop, yeah. You can get all manner of Prince-related items there. You can get Prince's records, Prince's clothes, and of course his famous tinned red salmon. Why do pop stars think that they can run shops? Do you remember now the flock of seagulls ate till late shops? Yeah? Or there was the anti-nowhere league chain of cancer research shops? Then of course, there was this. The Bell Stars. Everything for a pound shop. It's a sign of the times.
It's a sign of the times. Time to be alone.
Like a lot of bad things. Global warming, skin cancer, Freddie Starr. Pop stars opening shops started in the 1960s. Funny time, really, the 1960s. I mean, in many ways, everything in Britain had been the same since, like, the 1850s, apart from occasionally you get a different kind of horse. Then suddenly, in the 60s, everything seemed to speed up. Take restaurants, for example. As a student in London, I used to eat solitary dinners of kippers on toast or cheese on nothing in a restaurant in the Fulham Road called the ABC, the Aerated Bread Company. It was a brown restaurant that sold brown food. What's the soup today? It's bran. Pudding? Bran. You have to remember that up until the mid-1950s in Britain, all the colours of the rainbow were rationed, although you could get brown coupons. Then, in an instant, sometime in the mid-60s, everything suddenly changed. On the site of what had once been the ABC, a different restaurant opened almost every night. It was like watching a stop-frame film of the sky. Every time you blinked, the whole scene had changed. Once the ABC closed down, it was reborn as Abby's Alabama Pancake Nightmare. Fortunately, the nightmare was a short one, and it closed within 2 months. The lease was then sold to Captain Sid's Exploding Trousers Magic Circus Theatre Company, and they opened a cooperatively run restaurant called Can't Pay, Don't Pay, in which the customer paid whatever they thought the meal was worth, which, unsurprisingly, was generally nothing. I went there a few times with friends from college, and each time we did a runner, not realising, of course, that we didn't have to.
When Captain Sid's closed down, it then became, in quick succession, the International House of Haddock, the Haggis Palace. Then it became a Haitian restaurant called Papa Doc's. When the owner died, it was passed on to his Jewish son-in-law, and for a while it became Papa Dentist's. Then, coming into the 80s, there was the Lithuanian Muffin Machine, and then Simple Simon's House of Pies, which later became Learning Disability Rashid's Casa de Samosas. The mid-80s were a happy time for the restaurateur. In quick succession, there were three fads which were a boon to the greedy owner. First, there was Nouvelle Cuisine, where you could serve tiny portions and charge a fortune for it. Then there was Cajun cooking, where you could burn food and charge a fortune for it. Then there was tapas, where you could serve up a potato, call it patatas bravas, and charge a fortune for it. The recession put an end to all that. And the restaurant has been, amongst others, the Designer Jam Pizza Company and David Baddiel's Sports Bar for Insecure Jews.
And now, as we approach the millennium, the restaurant that has replaced them all specialises in modern British cuisine and is called ABC. And I sit alone, eating cheese on toast and kippers.
Or it'd definitely be a surprise if...
Mummy, Mummy!
Yes?
Daddy's having an affair with a married man.
That is a surprise.
There are two main arguments in support of fox hunting. One is that foxes kill chickens, but then so does Bernard Matthews. And nobody advocates hunting him down with dogs and tearing him apart. Well, nobody except me, that is, and everybody I know. The other is that fox hunting is a sport, but this I can't accept. All sports feature people of almost equal resources competing fairly against each other. Fox hunting features on the one side men, bugles, horses, dogs and Land Rovers, and on the other side a fox. If other sports were run on similar lines, rugby union would feature 15 burly men against a little rabbit.
It's as if I was in a javelin competition with this man, and I was allowed to post my javelin as far away as I liked. Quebec should do it.
That's how fair fox hunting is. But for some people, even that isn't enough. These 60 square miles of Hampshire behind me will be out of bounds for the next 500 years because the West Evesham Hunt decided that men, bugles, horses, Land Rovers and dogs weren't enough and changed the rules to allow the use of chemical warheads. They took out six medium-sized market towns. They're just not sure if they got the fox. Scattered around the country in various prime locations are a chain of American-owned restaurants called TGI Fridays, which stands for Thank God It's Fridays. But the thing is, usually it isn't, is it? I mean, usually it's not Fridays, or even Fridays. I mean, there's only a 1 in 7 chance of it being Friday, isn't it? I mean, what the bloody hell is that all about, eh? I mean, already we have rapacious mega-corporations parroting green slogans while raping the Earth's resources. We don't need restaurants confusing us about what bloody day it is! While I'm on the subject, one of the things that really annoys me about the catering trade is when you see in the window of a sandwich bar a poster that reads, "Try our delicious salt beef." Now, these posters are always the same, white letters on a red background. And presumably, the sandwich bar owner didn't print the poster themselves. But what I want to know is, how do the printers know whether the salt beef is delicious or not? I mean, do they insist on trying the salt beef before they do any printing? I don't think so. I mean, if I was a printer, sure, I'd insist on free samples before I did any work at all. But you can bet your bottom dollar that most people are not so conscientious.
No, most printers just sell try our delicious salt beef posters without knowing whether it's delicious or whether it's all dry and gummy and yucky and flaky with horrible bits that should be cut off but are instead sold to innocent comedians in the Gray's Inn Road for £2.50. And it's not the money. It's not the money, honestly. It's just that when you've been looking forward to your lunch ever since you got up 5 hours ago and then it's ruined, then it's ruined and you can never get your lunchtime back, can you? My God, how do these people sleep at night?
All right, everyone, settle down. Media Studies, Module 201. A Living Dinosaur, the Modality of the Northern Club Comedian. And our guest speaker today is Mr. Bobby Chariot, who I believe is going to be asking us, how are we diddling? Please welcome Mr. Bobby Chariot.
All right, how you diddling? Bloody sodgy then. Bobby Chariot here, top warm-up man and comedian, here to keep you laughing and smiling through your studies despite the disasters of my personal life. Separated from me wife, sleeping in me jag, on pills for me nerves. Okay, I bought the wife a plant the other day. It was a nuclear power plant. Okay, here we go, Bobby Chariot, top comedian. You know, my wife said I was a hopeless alcoholic, right? She said I was a hopeless alcoholic. Not true at all, not true. I'm actually a very good alcoholic, yeah? Very good at the pissing of the trousers and the mumbling of the paranoid nonsense. Here. Don't you hate them bloody Germans, eh? Don't you hate them Germans? They bombed our house. No, hang on, that was the neighbours. Yeah. I must admit, though, it is a bit depressing sometimes, sleeping in the old jag, you know, sleeping in the jag. Great motor, great British motor, the bloody jag. And I must admit that sometimes I've resorted to recreational drugs. Recreational drugs. I don't know why they call them that. They're made out of bloody swings or something. Anyway, the other week, guys, I bought these drugs. Well, I thought they was drugs. It turned out it was curry powder, right? So anyway, I didn't know that at the time, right? So anyway, I smoked this curry powder. I went spark out, and for 2 weeks, I was in a coma.
Thank you very much, Bobby.
Hey, no, I'd just like to say, you've been a bloody wonderful audience. Jesus, I mean, you've been wonderful. You've been a fantastic audience. Don't let anybody badmouth your generation. You're fantastic. You know, if anybody wants a shag or anything, good girls want a shag, I'm parked in a disabled parking space. Anybody?
Isn't it a bore when people tell you coincidences, eh? I mean, they're a real bore's charter, aren't they, coincidences? Because your end of the conversation is reduced to expressions of fake awe. What? Exactly the same buttons. And the more hippie inclined, they actually ascribe mystical significance to coincidences, don't they? They say, like, you know when we found the jug, right? Well, finally, it had exactly the same handle as, like, the other jug. What do you think that means? It means you're a daft twat, that's what it means. God, it really pisses me off, you know. Really puts me on the piss bus to piss town. It puts me on the piss hovercraft to Pissington Bay. It puts me on the piss plane to Pissistan in the former Soviet Republic of Pissovia. It pisses me off. It just pisses me to piss. Piss. Wow, I get so annoyed. Another thing that really annoys me is astrology. When people say to me, what sign are you? I usually say, no overtaking, humpback bridge. Another thing that really annoys me is when people say, oh, it's typical, isn't it? Every time I leave my house without my umbrella, it starts to rain. If we actually examine that statement, it's the most extraordinary piece of mystical egotism. For that statement to be true, first of all, we have to presuppose the existence of a godlike entity. Now, this godlike entity, in addition to its usual jobs of looking after entropy and keeping all the planets spinning in their orbits, also has to be keeping an eye on your gaff to see when you pop out without your brolly or not. Once this all-powerful being sees you are sans parapluie, it will then cause minute drops of water in clouds to coalesce to form larger drops. And when these drops become sufficiently heavy, they will fall as rain, wherever you happen to be. Doesn't seem likely, does it, when you really think about it?
Alexei exits left. Dot, dot, dot.
What I'm indulging in here is the classic writer with a deadline work avoidance gambit. You see, many in my profession will do absolutely anything to avoid confronting the blank screen or the blank page. Housework takes on a sudden fascinating attraction. You think, oh yes, I'll go and help my neighbour replace the clutch on his tractor. People often theorise about who carved the giant stone heads on the Pacific Atoll of Easter Island. I know who it was. It was a single comedy writer who had a commission to finish a sitcom pilot for Channel 4 over the weekend. The Egyptian temples at Abu Simbel were carved by writers from Brookside, and the Grand Union Canal was dug by David Croft and Jimmy Perry, creators of Dad's Army.
Who do you think you are kidding, Mr. Hitler?
So, the thing is, I haven't written the next bit of the show yet.
Yes?
The Alexei Sayle show's finished.
That is a surprise.